How are you?
Oh, it's so good to see you.
Glad we could catch up today.
Hope you haven't been waiting
long. Not too long.
In a town that loves power lunching, it's always about who you're with and where you're going.
Oh, I love it here.
I'm talking to the leading minds on energy and giving you a taste of DC.
I was just staring at all the really yummy treats.
I'm Monica Trauzzi, and this is Off the Menu. So what are some of your favorite foods? I mean, I hope you like fish, right?
I love fish. I grew up in Louisiana, big seafood guy, love oysters, love crabs, living in Chesapeake Bay. Spent a lot of time in the Navy, so I've been on the world's oceans, been to Japan several times, love sushi.
Oh, that's fantastic, yeah.
So I'm a big fan of what we're having here today.
So obviously Russia and China are big players in the energy space. And when we think about trade deals that are happening, when we think about the Middle East and Russia and China making plays in that region, how does the U.S. maintain its competitiveness when these big players are heading into those regions?
That's a difficult challenge for most U.S. companies, if not all companies. If you look at both Russia and China, they have state-owned or government-owned enterprises that are marketing their technology very robustly throughout the world. Russia, through its Rosatom, is marketing projects in Turkey, Vietnam, throughout many other countries in the former Soviet sphere area. The United States can't compete with that because we're not using or not employing a model that has government-owned utilities or government-owned vendors, so to speak. It's very difficult, and I think Congress and policymakers have to realize that difference. It's significant.
Bill, I'm interested in understanding a little more about this intersection of national security and energy policy. What is it that you think people really need to know about that?
The way I look at it is, as far as energy is concerned, I'm an all-of-the-above person. I want to have all aspects of energy supply available for us, not just today, but 50 years, 100 years from now. And to do that, you have to invest in various sectors. With the low price of shale natural gas over the last decade and the plentiful supplies, it's made nuclear on the electrical generating capacity side much more challenged financially. Yet, if we don't place some type of a value on nuclear as far as its baseload generation, irrespective of what the wind is, with respect to its reliability, it's been a very reliable source for this country. We run the risk of not encouraging investment, and we'll have nuclear plants that continue to close down because they can't compete with gas. If we don't diversify our energy supply sources in a way that incentivizes utilities to continue to operate nuclear plants, we may very well find ourselves 30 years from now with the inability to have nuclear power as a commercial generating source for electricity in this country. That would be a shame.
And you've worked for both Democratic and Republican administrations. Do you view energy as bipartisan, nonpartisan, or is there this new sort of partisanship that's emerged?
I think it's largely bipartisan. I don't think there's any really polarization over energy sources. Certainly there have been some political disagreements on carbon emissions and global warming policies. But by and large, I think everybody on both sides of the aisle supports having an energy policy that incentivizes all of the above and keeping all options open for the future. Great, thank you. This looks delicious.
This does look delicious.
Yeah,
shumai is one of my favorite things.
Grab that part of it.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Monica.
Nice to see you.
Likewise.